from our studio in Atlantic City, and tonight from Sacred Heart Medical Center in Spokane, Washington, I'm David Spatz. And coming up next, we'll sit down with singer and songwriter Paul Anka on tonight's edition of Curtain Call, and it all starts right now. And that was Paul Anka on stage, and this is Paul Anka off stage. Paul,
here I be.
Good hey, to David. See you.
Always good to good see you. It's been a while.
It's been a while, but for you, it's been a bigger while because this is an anniversary year for you, mm-hmm. isn't it? 1957 to 2007, 50 years.
Yeah, April, 50 years since Diana.
Wow.
I don't know where it's gone, but here I am, thankfully.
It's gone to an incredible career is where it's gone.
Yeah, very quickly, a lot of stuff in there. And very reflective, I would say now, because I'm writing the book, just signed a big book deal with St. Martin's Press. So I'm in the midst of it.
Is that your first book?
Yeah, I've stayed away from it for a while.
Yeah, why? I mean, you didn't stay away from everything else in the business, but you stayed away from that.
Probably waiting for a couple more people to die. So I could tell it all.
That way they can't sue you or what?
I was just never ready. You know, I felt that there's still a lot going on for me, and you know, it's not an every month thing, every year thing, obviously. So I was just trying to wait for the right time and when I could really get to it. You know, I haven't really put my flag in the mountain from my point of view. So to address that years ago, I wasn't really ready to do that. But now I think by the time it comes out next year, it'll be cool.
So is this going to be a tell-all book? I mean, are there stories in here that the public doesn't know about Paul Anka?
It'll be all that in terms of... it's not going to be fluff, and it's not going to be run out quick. I mean, there's 50 years. You know, there's a lot of stuff in there. I'm certainly going to talk about most of it, perhaps, not all.
Right.
And I've just kind of waited, you know, for the 50 years, and I've been, you know, getting all the material together, and, you know, it's cathartic. Mm-hmm. And, yeah, I'm going to probably dish out about 80% of it, yeah.
You say it's cathartic. Mm-hmm. Have you been keeping a lot inside of you? Is there stuff the public doesn't know that's going to
sure
come out?
There's a lot that the public doesn't know. Mm-hmm. I mean, so it would be that way, I would say, with most people other than those that really use the media and thrive on it. You know, from my point of view, I've always been under the radar. There's a lot of nuance and dynamics and events that went on that... you know, I went on the Howard Stern show, and I started, you know, just getting into the rap about the Vegas thing and the guys and all that stuff. People were calling in, will you write a book, will you write a book? And that really kind of pushed me quicker toward it. And I realized there was a lot of interest in, you know, those days, the mm-hmm. 50s, the 60s, the 70s. And there's so much stuff that I've been...
You were kind of old before your time back then, though, weren't you? When you were hanging out with Sinatra and Martin and Sammy and that whole crowd.
Yeah.
But you were still the kid.
Yeah, I was always the kid. I was certainly, I was old for my age. You know, I had a lot of tenacity and I really lived a much older life, you know, due to really the way that I wanted to live my life.
Mm-hmm.
And it was an experience that, really paid off in later years. You know, I look back at it and I try to articulate it to a lot of young artists that I sit with, and you know, Michael Bublé, who I was involved in his career and his first album. And it was just amazing when you start explaining to them all that stuff and what it was about. I mean, they look at you and they thrive to know what it was like. I mean, right down to walking into a studio with one microphone and a band and having to get it. I mean, they can't comprehend what it was like in that day of it, a business that was in its infancy stage.
But even as a younger artist, you were always straddling the line and operating on two different levels. You were able to write the commercial, for lack of a better term, bubblegum sounds, like Put Your Head on My Shoulders and Puppy Love and Diana. And at the same time, you were writing far more sophisticated music, like, well, the theme for The Longest Day for Daryl F. Zanuck, and the Tonight Show theme, Johnny's theme.
Mm-hmm.
in 1961, before you were 21 years old.
Yeah.
Where did that musical sensibility come from? I mean, and the ability to kind of straddle that line.
It's an unknown. It's very hard to define and articulate the creative talent, where it is. You know, it's some kind of a gift. You know, it's something within you. But to sit down and really give you a block by block as to what it is, I have no idea. You know, I live it, and it's in there, and you know, you kind of navigate to get it out. But precisely, I've never been able to figure that out, other than it's flowing and that you're gifted with something that constantly is manifesting itself with your observation to life or subliminally or whatever. But I have no idea at that young age what that was about, other than I can relate to my emotions. I can relate to being turned on by a young girl named Diana, by being moved by Daryl Zanuck and standing on the beaches of Normandy, and even at my young age, you know, understanding the ramifications and the depth of it, and then it comes out of music. Mm-hmm. How? I don't know where this. I didn't know where my way. You know, I sat with Sinatra, what, in my 20s, and he's quitting show business, and I introduced him to Costa, who's my producer, and just at dinner in Miami one night. I mean, the guy says, "I'm quitting," and I was like, "Quitting?" You know, and I knew he was doing one more album, and you know, to go home and get motivated to. Where does it now, the end comes now? I mean, I sit there at the end of it at 5 in the morning, and I realize, where did that come from? You know?
You never struggled, though, to write songs, did you? Whether it was My Way or Put Your Head on My Shoulders. Did you struggle?
No, it was never a struggle. It was always a craft that you had to deal with.
Mm-hmm.
I think in the mid-60s, I went dry, you know, after the British invasion and kind of looking at myself and saying, you know, what really is in store for me, and which led to My Way. But it was more of a dry effect than a struggling effect.
Was it dry? Were you dry, or was the industry dry on you?
I think it was both.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think there were a lot of casualties. You know,
you weren't the only one. I mean, just about every American artist,
years
you know.
Before when the Beatles hit, a lot of my buddies got wiped out. But then I had some, you know, legs because of The Longest Day and The Tonight Show theme, and I was working clubs. But if you fall right in that gap, because hard rock really hit in the mid-60s. And, you know, that diffuses a lot of things. We were into that disposable society, in effect. And, you know, you're no longer, you know, readily in the front. You no longer had a window, you were no longer the flavor of the month of the year, so you have to take stock and go, okay, how do I reinvent? What is that going to be? So, you know, you sit down and write songs you don't like.
Put your head on my shoulder. I'll do the singing, honey, you just dance. Whisper in my ear. What's your name?
Chet.
What is it?
Chet.
Chet. I don't believe my eyes. Of all the women I could have picked, I found one just my size. You don't know until you begin, yeah. Can't you see me standing here? I got my back against the record machine. I ain't the worst that you've seen. You see what I mean? You might as well jump. Go ahead, jump. Over here, jump. One more, jump. You gotta knock yourself up.
The hard rock sound kind of put you on the sidelines for a while, but then you got even 2 years ago with Rock Swings. You embraced the rock sound, but you heard swing music in it. And I mean, you look at the list, like Tears in Heaven by Eric Clapton, Jump by Van Halen, and then the one everybody's talking about, and you know which one. It Smells Like Teen Spirit by Nirvana.
With the lights out, less days. Here we are now. Entertain us. I feel stupid. Contagious. Here we are now. Entertain us. I'm a mulatto, an albino, a mosquito.
Where did this whole idea that there is swing music in rock, where did it come from?
Well, it came, I've always been motivated every decade because I got onto this Billboard statistic. I was the only artist that had top 50 record every decade. So I kept a promise to myself, whatever I had to do, every decade I was gonna have a chart record. So here I was in my sixth decade and I was doing the Michael Bublé album. And realized that there was a window for this swing. And Robbie Williams was doing it, a lot of young artists, but they're doing the standards and all of that. Mm-hmm. So when we blew out with the Bublé and started to get very successful, which I produced with David Foster, the record comes and said, do a swing album, you know, the Porter. I said, you know, no, nobody's interested mm-hmm. in Anka doing that. I've done it all my life. They're interested in these young kids doing it, but there is something that as I was morphing into the Bublé project, I realized there was a lot of good songs, not putting them apple per apple to Gershwin and those guys, mm-hmm. understanding the social ramifications and what it was about, but there's some great songs in the 70s and 80s that can swing. Well, you're a musician and a songwriter, you can get inside of that and envision it. You know, if you're just an artist, you're not gonna really get it.
Right.
Anyway, long story short, I sat there with the charts and I went through about 300 songs in my studio with my guys and I just went one by one, process of elimination, and we tested it and it started to morph into some great credibility. I said, okay, this is going to work, but the money's going in the band, the musicianship, the studio, everything, the arrangers, very important, and we're going to take these songs and reinvent them. So that after the knee-jerk reaction of what, Paul Anka, you know, I just wanted them to hear it. And if they were astute enough and fair, and most critics are, I mean, mm-hmm. they have a sensibility and they're sophisticated. If they hear it, they'll get it. So we threw it out there and nothing was tentative. It was all very precisely put together. It started going gold everywhere from Germany, mm-hmm. then it went to England and then to France and then Canada.
He released it.
All over the world. Oh, just
but before you released it in the States, though, right?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Well, hit all the charts over there.
That was obviously a calculated move?
Well, no. It was necessary because the money came from Germany. They were tied into Sony.
Okay.
You know, a lot of our companies are owned foreign.
Mm-hmm.
It started in Germany, which is one of the biggest record markets in the world. Went right top five. I was up there with 50 cents. I mean, we were number one on every... Anyway, we blew it out there, then we started spreading it. Because of the nature of the music business anyway today, there are slots that you have to wait for.
Right.
So we took it right from there. So we did really well with it, and we've just finished the second one, which is very exciting.
Paul, was this a gamble for you? Was it a crapshoot? I mean, could Paul Anka have been hurt by this album?
You know, I wasn't going to release it unless I was really sold. I didn't have a lot to lose in terms of, look, I've done it all. I've been very, very fortunate in working hard, but I've derived a lot out of this industry. But I knew in my relationship with the company was, if this doesn't work and I don't like it, we scrap it and the money goes down the toilet. But I knew when we tested it and you listened to the arrangements and we went to certain key critics and they heard it, I had a sense that people were going to embrace this. So it wasn't a crapshoot. Listen, if people buy quality, which they don't always do,
right.
You put it in there, you got a shot of making it. It was not a novelty record.
All right, so how do you follow up an album like Rock Swings?
I didn't want to do Rock Swings 2. That just, I would have been killed. But a good portion of the attitude that's in Rock Swings is on here. There's some great swing arrangements to some great contemporary songs, no old standards. I'm testing one of my old songs, You Are My Destiny, with Michael Bublé in a very jazz up-tempo, because one day I may do a lot of those in a concept. So you have that, you've got Joni Mitchell. I found an obscure Bob Dylan song called Farewell Angelina, which is on there. We have I took time after time, Cyndi Lauper, if you can believe it. It is the coolest arrangement. Randy Kerber just killed on it. The Killers, Mr. Brightside. it's unreal. And it's such fun and motivating. You know, when you go in with the stuff that you're familiar with, it's familiar. Mm-hmm. It's though you're professional in articulating it, it's not the challenge that these are. I love the challenge that was put forth with these songs, because you really, there's no room for error in there.
When you're writing music, what comes first for you, the words or the music? Or does it vary?
Sometimes the first line and then the music. I've very rarely written words and then put, She's a Lady was the closest to it, where I wrote a lot of the words and then put the music. But primarily when you're the composer and the lyricist, you get your lyric idea, which motivates you to the structure. So I get my melody structure, because the word has to land on something. So for me, it's the melody.
Paul, given your stature in the industry, I'm sure a lot of young composers approach you and want to pick your brain. What advice do you give them about the business these days?
Well, it's varied through the years. I think in the latter years, I tell them, learn to be an accountant. They laugh at me. But, you know, it's very
true. If it's in your bank book, they wouldn't laugh.
Yeah, exactly. So they have to really, take control of themselves. It's too easy to say that, because a lot of artists really don't have business acumen.
But you did that early on with yourself.
I did it early because, you know, I was ripped off a little, and which is okay. And I just realized at one point that for me to function the way I like to function, I have to have some control. And I like control of my life, because it's just... And I don't get claustrophobic, and I can really focus on what I'm doing. I get very lost in everything if I'm being manipulated.
Would you call yourself a control freak?
No. I'm certainly controlling.
Mm-hmm.
Not a freak in a sense where I have to control everything, but I'm very hands-on. I'm very focused, dedicated, and professional to 24 hours a day. And the people that don't, you know, function that I'm working with, I get very irritated about it, because I just don't take everything, secondhand.
You have been a success in just about everything you have ever attempted, whether it's been singing, songwriting, live shows, acting, and one of your biggest successes has been in the business world. Where did all of this business acumen come from?
Just somebody like Irving Feld, people that I was around as a young boy that started to teach me what it was about, because I was interested. And then it goes back to the fact of, you know, even in the late 50s, when the record company stopped kind of believing and I wanted to buy my masters back,
mm-hmm.
I started to realize that I've got to have that kind of business sense, because I wasn't going to last in a business that I loved being in. I just couldn't envision me doing anything else after having that penetrating opening shot with Diana and all those hits. I went, damn, I can't let this go. I better start learning about what this business is about. I mean, it hurts you and it helps you, you know. It's tough to wear all those hats, because, you know, a lot of artists, you know, there's a lot of hypocrisy and fakery about it, because they're, you know, they're taught just to be nice and sweet, but meanwhile they're back there nudging a group of people to go out and kick ass for them, and I just kick up my own ass. So, you know, I've got a reputation of being tough and this and this and that, and which is okay, because it's really worked for me well, you know, because I know what's good for me.
You look back over 50 years, and I'm sure there are things that you would want to change if you could, but for the most part, you happy with the last half century?
Yeah, I feel somewhat embarrassed and not happy with myself to really complain about regrets.
Mm-hmm.
They've been minimal. I think that when I look back at it and assess it all, you know, I'm pretty much happy with the way it went. Could I fix some things? Yeah. Could have I behaved a little better? Yeah. Could I have, you know, but you know, that's not what life is. You know, when you sit at the point that I'm at and you see these young kids today that are just so spoilt and ungrateful for what they've been given, and they're all these Hollywood brats that are sitting there ruining their lives, you know, strictly in an open eye field of people who are struggling in our country and who can't make a living. You know, I resent that kind of crap. So for me to sit back and, you know, maybe I'll sit there and just kind of with a little score sheet and say, what if, but to go vocal about it, you know, I feel like a putz doing that, because by and large, I always landed on my feet. It's always been the way that I've wanted it. No, I don't have anything really. I mean, it's more personal issues that I would really want to do differently than business issues, because at the end of the day, the older you get, the more you realize, you know, what is it really all about? What really matters? And what really matters is, you know, the people you've affected and, you know, what you've given to them, because the stuff you learn later in life is meaningless, and after you're gone, it's just a bunch of garbage. It doesn't mean anything. But how have you affected a human being? How have you affected people? How have you helped someone? Mm-hmm. That kind of stuff. So I don't have any regrets.
You said, though, that you had maybe a few regrets, and it made me think of the line in My Way, regrets I've had a few, but then again, too few to mention.
Yeah.
But I'm wondering, did you write that for Sinatra or more for Paul Anka at the time?
Yeah, I think, listen, there's a lot of Paul Anka in a lot of the songs, and some are just crafted songs. Certainly, you know, My Way is my song. It's about, you know, my life, but it's also about millions of other people who feel the same way. The deviation and the lyric and the confidence of going further in it are lines like Ate It Up and Spit It Out and Chew, which are all indigenous to the way Sinatra talked. You knew him, and
yes,
I knew him, and he motivated you that way because that's how he spoke, or that's how his whole body language and his whole philosophy and culture was. So that in itself motivated me to write like that. But when you talk about regrets I've had of too few to mention, yeah, that was me.
Sure, you mentioned him in your book, I'm sure.
Oh man, I got a huge chapter about him. I got a lot of chapters.
I'll bet.
Yeah.
Paul, it's been a remarkable 50 years. It's been a remarkable 15 or 20 minutes. So I want to thank you for being a good friend over the years.
Yeah, you and I have known each other a lot. We've shared a lot. We've certainly seen a lot.
We have, and I hope we see more.
It's always good to see you. Yeah, well, I'm
sure
always on the track.
You know, I know that. I know that. Continued success.
Thank you.
And we'll be back with more right after this.
Well, as we look back on 20-plus years of Curtain Call, we pulled out the Paul Anka show because we shot it in one of the most unlikely spots we've ever done a show. It was in the doctor's lounge at Sacred Heart Medical Center in Spokane, Washington. Why? Well, Paul's wife was rushed to the hospital to be treated for food poisoning, and once she was stabilized, Paul insisted on sitting down with us, and the doctor's lounge was the closest thing we could come up with to a quiet room. It was an interesting evening that ended at about 4 in the morning.
Why aren't you here? Yes, you can come back. I'll see you next year. Somebody, somebody, somebody.